All right, welcome back to section 6 of our introduction to machine learning for material science. So far we've done a bunch of setup, we've built our default model, and now we're moving on, if I scroll down to section 6, which is on optimization of the model. So now we're gonna start making some changes and see, can we improve the model? So I'm gonna click on the hyperlink and jump down here. Again, I'll skip over a bunch of the kind of background text, but if you're wanting to learn in more detail about this, I encourage you to read through and follow along with the exercises. So jumping in here, I'm going to start running through a few of the cells at the top here. And the key thing that we're going to do here with these first couple cells is we're going to set up what are the things that we can actually, or we're going to look at what are the things we can change about this model, and we're going to decide how we're going to change those. So what I'm printing out here, using this command here, is we're printing out the hyperparameters of the model. So hyperparameters are things that affect how the model learns. So previously we looked a little bit about this decision tree model, and if you remember, we looked at the way it makes predictions is it makes these splits on different nodes in the tree, and eventually it gets to the bottom of the tree, and wherever it lands, it sort of makes the prediction from that node. So there's a number of things we could change. For example, we could set something like the max depth of the tree. So we could say you can only have this number of layers in the tree. After you get to that point, you can't make any more splits. So that would be one way to limit the complexity of the tree. There's a bunch of things that do that in different ways. You could do maximum leaf nodes. So this is each individual node at the bottom of the tree. So you could limit that. What you see right now is that this is generally set up so that there's no limits on the tree. It can build as large and complex as it wants to. There's nothing limiting how it's getting generated. And the other thing to point out is this parameter here called n estimators. So this is number of estimators, or another way to phrase this is number of trees. So previously we said, we just have one decision tree, but we aren't limited to that. We could make a bunch of different trees, and then we could get the average results of all of those and use that as our prediction. And that's a slightly different modification to this decision tree framework, and oftentimes that's called a random forest. So that's what we're going to do going forward, is we're going to say, what we saw previously is that a single tree, didn't perform very well, but we're going to say, what happens if we start increasing the number of trees that we include? So that's what we're going to do here in this next cell. So we set this whole range of things to investigate. We're going to look at 1, 3, 5, 7, up to 50. And we're basically going to build all these different models. We're going to do the exact same assessment we did in the previous section, and then we're going to look at the performance across all of those values. So this is this process here, broadly could be described as a grid search process. We're just going to grid out the number of values that we're interested in, and then we're going to try them all. And this is very easy to do if we just want to investigate one hyperparameter. However, we could form a much more high dimensional grid. If we said, okay, we don't only want to look at the number of trees, we also want to look at things like the max depth or these other things like max samples, max leaf nodes, all these other hyperparameters which are shown in the middle of the screen here. For now, we're going to keep it fairly simple. And this is mostly just in the interest of having things run a little quickly. You might imagine, if we start investigating many different hyperparameters at one time, things will slow down considerably because we have to build a single model for each of those. And even though each model is pretty fast, as we start adding more trees, they do get quite a bit slower. So we've set up, here's the things we want to investigate. We make a dictionary out of them here. And then in the next cell, we will start to actually do that grid search. So that here is the cell where we actually do the grid search. You can see it's using this method, grid search CV. And this takes, I think, 15, 20 seconds, a little bit of time to run through. You can see this asterisk here means it's still running. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna let that run, and then we'll see what our results look like once it finishes. One section I think I skipped over a little bit is on this setting up a cross-validation scheme. This is, I'm gonna gloss over this a little bit, but this is very similar to doing the train and test splits we were talking about earlier. This is just a slightly more complex way of doing it. And it's a way that we're going to use as we do the grid search. So instead of just doing a single train and test split, we're going to make many different train and test splits for each grid point. So it looks like our search is completed. And from the output, it tells us, so it took 26 seconds. And number of estimators it found was 50. So it thought 50 was the best. And we can look in a little more detail. If we just go down to the next slides, we can visualize, you know, what did the performance look like as we looked at the different number of trees. So for example, we were looking at, again, yeah, number of trees was our hyperparameter. And what we can do is make something called a learning curve type of plot, where we plot the performance versus that parameter that we're changing. And we can do the same thing for the training set and the validation set. And what we see for the points here on, in both cases, is that they both seem to just be decreasing as we increase the number of trees. And specifically, I should say, we're decreasing the error. So the metric we're using here is the mean squared error on the left side, on the y-axis there. And we see that that's decreasing continually, which just means that adding more trees seems to be giving us better performance overall. And while with one tree, which is where we started, we had an error of 2.6 or so, now we're down to 1.4, which is quite a dramatic change from where we started. So this is one way of, again, doing this optimization. We did this in a very simple way where we just looked at one hyperparameter. But if you're interested in going back and you're confident making a few changes, you could easily change, you know, what you're investigating, what hyperparameters you want to consider. You could maybe go above 50. You could say, what happens if you go to 100 or 200? They'll definitely start to slow down a lot more the more trees you add. So I'll give you a little bit of a warning there. But you could definitely start looking at that. You could even change, again, what hyperparameters you're looking at and do this same type of thing. So if we consider that case with 50 trees to be our optimized model, now we can go back and look in more detail about how does the model compare to where we started with. Excuse me. So I'm running through a few of the outputs here. I think I'll skip over these results for now. This is showing the cross-validation results, or maybe I won't skip over it entirely, but very quickly. So with the optimized cross-validation, we can report, you know, what are the, again, the error metrics that we found. So we have the average RMSE for the cross-validation. And with the optimized, it was 1.13, and previously it was 1.48. So it seems like it's definitely decreasing. This is, again, the same kind of conclusion we had previously with the learning curve, just a different way to kind of visualize it, or quantify it, I should say. And what we can go back to now with our default and optimized model is we can say, what about our training and original test set? So all of this that we've been doing has been just on this training set where we've been making splits within the training set. So now we can go back and say, okay, let's predict the original test set that we had. And let's look at what that performance looks like. So again, here's the training data that we started with the default model. Remember that it was all like on a line. However, now it looks pretty different. So now there's actually a spread around that line. And this is an interesting comparison to make because, you know, at this very surface level, you'd say, oh, it looks like this is performing worse than previous, right? Because previously it was all on the line here. However, when we go look at the test set, which is what we're more interested in, if I go generate these plots, so here's the test parity plot that we had previously. However, now the test set is getting much better. So what it looks like is that while the training set, you know, decreased in performance a little bit, the test set, which we really care about, actually increased in performance. So this is where we're getting that gain in performance that we saw previously. And again, if we look through the error metrics here, previously the RMSE was 1.23, now it's 0.6. So we basically halved the error, which is really cool to see. And all the other metrics improved as well. And if you want to dig into what those are, they're again included in the text if you want to read through and learn about them. So the kind of conclusion from the optimization is that previously we had a model that was really well fit to just the training data, right? It was predicting it right on the line, but the test data didn't have great performance. But now we have a model that is predicting the test data really well. And the reason is that it's not so tightly fit onto all the training data. It's a much more kind of generalized model. So even though there's a little bit of error here, it's able to predict the test data much more accurately. And this is something that comes up with a lot of different model types. When you sort of start off, it might be overfit to the data. So by reducing that overfitting, you can improve the test data predictions a lot more. So I think that gets us through, yeah, all of the optimization section. There's a few different, again, as you've been looking through, exercises that go along with this. So if you want to dig into a little more detail on those, I'd encourage you to do so, but that gets us through our optimized model. And with the last step, we're going to go through and actually make a few predictions at the end. And we'll see, you know, how is our model performing with some predictions that we're going to make. So I'll catch you there.